thank you. You're clear for takeoff on runway 10, and on your turn, make a right turn and remain west of Papa, please.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another thrilling episode of our Aviation Odyssey. Today, we're in for an exhilarating ride as we sit down with a true master of the skies, Kellie Hudson, the brilliant air boss behind multiple air shows and air displays around the country. On this episode, we'll be tuning in to the live air show radio waves, capturing the pulse of aviation excitement, and uncovering the behind-the-scenes magic that brings these spectacular events to life. Fasten your seatbelts, folks, because this episode promises to be an unforgettable flight. Kellie, welcome to From the Right Seat. I'm so very excited to be talking with you and getting your insight of the aviation world you're involved in. So let's get into it. Tell us a little bit about yourself. What's your background? Why did you choose such an interesting career in aviation such as yours?
Let me start off with, my name is Kellie Hudson, for those of you who don't know who I am. I am an air boss on the industry. I am from Houston, Texas, very, very proud Texan, even though I have been gone since 1996 when I graduated high school. Went in the Air Force right at 18, did not know what I was getting into. It was kind of, you're going in the Air Force or you're out of the house type thing with my parents. They were both law enforcement in Houston. Tested, did my testing with the recruiter, and they were like, do you want to be an air traffic controller? I said, what's that? They explained it to me, and I said, sure, why not? Get me out of Houston. It's time for me to move on. So I went to basic training and tech school, and I fell in love with it and ended up staying 20 years in the Air Force, traveling all over the United States and all over the world as an air traffic controller. And then after my 20 years, I did an additional 5 as a contractor, with the government as a contract controller in Northern Nevada. And during that time, I found out about a program called the Air Boss Program in 2017, which seemed like the perfect fit for me. I was always involved in air shows throughout my Air Force career, just air crew hospitality, ground ops, helping out wherever I could. And when I learned about this air boss academy to go to and train to be an air boss, I was like, this is the perfect fit for me, because I also got my education while I was in the Air Force with the intention of opening my own events planning company when I retired, with my, you know, master's in business. It didn't go so well. I did 6 months of that in the civilian world and realized I missed planes a lot. So with that being said, went to ICAS in 2017, met all the, when I say big bosses, you know, the big four, you got, you know, Wayne and Tooch and Ralph and George, and basically begged and pleaded on my knees to let them, to allow me to come to a show with them. So I started traveling in 2018 on the circuit with all those bosses. I think I booked about, I think I did like 13 shows with them throughout the year. Thank God my work was very flexible.
Mm-hmm.
And then in 2019, I actually got certified.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
I mean, that's in a nutshell. Obviously, it's more in depth.
Right. Yeah.
What I went through. Yeah. Multiple steps, classes, courses, tests, so many show venues that you have to go to before you can get certified. But it just seemed to be the perfect fit for me, and still is to this day.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Love what you do, and you don't ever work a day in your life.
Oh, no, it's my passion. Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Absolutely fit for me. There's no other job that is fit for me.
So. And having been with you in the tower at AIRSHO in Midland this year, it was definitely apparent that it is your passion. It was absolutely amazing to watch you do what you do. And the time we spent together was absolutely mind blowing for what you actually do and what actually goes into it. So,
oh, yeah. I had a blast.
But why air boss? Why air shows? Why? I know you said you had, 25 years as air traffic controller. That's completely different than air bossing an air show.
Well, obviously it gave me the skills and the knowledge that I needed. You don't have to be an air traffic controller to be an air boss. It's definitely helped me out. Honestly, it's the feeling. And I was just talking about this to some performers last weekend at a show. It's the feeling that I get the first time I key the mic and I speak to now, which is not a plane, it's a person that I know, that I love, that I value and respect. So as soon as I key that mic, it's like this fire, like lights up in me. And all I want to do is put on a great show for the spectators and for everybody there. And then at the end, you know, you look around and you see all the faces and they're smiling and it's like, you're their hero, no matter what position. You know, you think an air boss and an announcer are on the stand and it's the performers that get the glory, but no, we get it behind the scenes. There's people that look up at us and are like, I really want to do that. And I'm like, let's go. You know, you too can do it. I never knew, but it's a passion. It's a feeling that I can't describe. I mean, I left my career, my corporate career this year to just do air bossing and do shit.
And that says a lot. And that says a lot.
I love it.
That is so cool. And like you said, I didn't even know that air bossing was a thing until, you know, well, I have to say I've been to air shows before, but I didn't know what goes on the background until I joined the CAF Gulf Coast Wing, and I started to tour with Texas Raiders and Little Raiders and our SNJ, going to these air shows, Wings Over Houston, and what was the other air show that I went to? We had to go to Austin 1 year, and we did flyover with four other aircraft. That was pretty cool, but that wasn't a boss thing. But Wings Over Houston was. It was absolutely astoundingly interesting to see one person orchestrating this whole organized chaos. And it was absolutely amazing to be able to come up in the tower and actually see that. So
it is organized times.
Can you share with our listeners what the role of an air boss entails during air shows or even aviation events, and what is your main responsibility and challenges?
Well, so I guess I don't like to repeat what other bosses have said. Some say it's the, you're the ringmaster of the circus. Some say you're the conductor of the orchestra. I agree with both of those, but being from Texas, I like to think that like I'm a rancher, like herding cattle. Not saying they're cattle, but they don't listen. Sometimes they do. You have multiple, you know, things that you're, you know, making sure in place before you start, you know, moving the performers, the cattle along. I hope no one's offended by me calling them cattle. I'm sure I'll have the performers. Oh, so now
Some of them are like, yeah, all right.
No, I mean, it starts like I'm already coordinating a show that's in April of next year. So it starts, you know, 6+ months out. If you're building an aerobatic box from scratch, if you're doing the paperwork and stuff like that. So yes, we do at some shows, dependent upon the show, we do all the paperwork for the FAA, ensuring that we have an approved waiver, which allows the performers to do things that they typically could not do in that airspace over that airport, over the water. You also have to block the airspace off, which is a whole nother agency. It's called a temporary flight restriction. We do that paperwork and that coordination. And then sometimes we're helping, you know, wrangle up performers for the shows. We throw a schedule together, and you want the schedule to not be, you know, same type throughout, you know, in a row. So you want, say, a flip-flop and a, you know, fighter. And then maybe, you know, you want to tell a story also, you know, some, you know, warbirds and CAF. And then we build from that, like where we started and where we are now. That being said, you're also coordinating with city officials, fire department, police department, air traffic control facilities. So lots of moving parts in just the prep for a show. And then once you're on site, we have a tabletop where we get all the emergency management, the producers of the show, the ground ops, myself, announcer in a room, and we discuss what ifs. What if this happens? This is what we.
So there's always a plan, no matter what.
Oh my gosh, yeah, there are so many A, B, C, D. If this happens, what we do, and that's all prior, you know, to the show week of. Then we move into the pilot safety brief each day before the shows, where I or any other air boss get to get up and, you know, talk about the show, explain to them the show lines, what they can and cannot do. Mm-hmm. We go through the schedule line by line so they know where they're supposed to be and when. We talk about any logistical needs that they have. We clear everything up in that safety briefing so they have no questions when they go to fly. And then I jump on the stand with the announcer and we kick it off and cross our fingers that everything goes as planned. Most of the time there's some little kinks, you know, but that's where you need to be flexible and, you know, adapt to, you know, every situation mm-hmm. that comes up, and that's where it becomes a production.
Right. That is so cool. So what would you say that your biggest challenges are?
The paperwork part. So, okay. You know, the challenges, you know, with the FAA, they are just like us in the airshow industry evolving.
Mm-hmm.
The ones that have been there for a long time are retiring. And if you notice at, you know, some of the shows you've been to this year, likewise with me, sometimes you could have 10 FAA people there because they're training new people. So therefore, mm-hmm. it becomes a challenge to read the lines of the regulations of what, you know, we have to go by and help them to sometimes understand what we're doing because they're not well-versed in it yet. And then sometimes they school us, you know? So,
right.
Yeah, the FAA and the coordination and getting the waiver done, I would say to me, has been the most challenging part of being an air boss.
Right. And paperwork as a whole is just a scary thing to think about, and especially with a federal agency looking down on you and working with the federal agency.
Aaron, it really helps when I was just speaking about this weekend. When you do mm-hmm. the work from the start to the finish, instead of having like the show do the paperwork, you and out even more than you do when you see it and have to look over it and, you know.
Right. And make amends to it if need be. That does make sense. That makes a lot of sense. Air shows are known for their absolute precision in choreography or routines. How do you plan and coordinate the movements of multiple aircraft in the air, not only on the air, but on the ground, to ensure safe and visually stunning performance?
Well, it kind of goes back to the schedule. Well, I think my background in air traffic control plays a huge role in this. Talking to planes on the ground and in the air, usually that's two separate controllers.
Mm-hmm.
In this instance, it's all the air boss.
Mm-hmm.
So some places are a challenge if they don't have multiple taxiways or taxiways are blocked. You got to get creative and back taxi down runways and whatnot while you have people in the air flying their routines.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if it's an art or if it's a gift, you know. But,
I would say a mixture of both.
Yeah, it's
because
visually,
that's where it comes with experience, right?
Yeah. I like to, when I get to a show, go to where I'm standing at show center. And, you know, you can look at a map all day and look at taxiways and role play your schedule that you've put together. But until you stand where you're going to be standing, looking out, get oriented with the airfield, the taxiways, then it's like the vision is there. So for me, it kind of comes naturally. I hate to say that. I'm pretty sure you could learn it, you know, but it's a natural thing for me to have planes moving on the ground, me talking to, you know, ground ops or airfield about something, maybe there's thought or something, and also having, you know, a performer in the air performing. So it's about multitasking, being able to manage that chaos. And I don't know if that's ever really been a challenge for me just because I've done it so much over the years as a controller, although we're not controllers as air bosses. But for instance, in Iraq, you know, when I was in Balad, Iraq in the tower in 2005, at the busiest single runway ops, you know, during the war, we had that and then some going on.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe it's my training over the years that has helped me do it to the best of my ability.
Right.
But that's where that comes from. And then the routines, like I said, the choreography and the routines, I mean, most of the performers have profiles. Very few don't, you know, like we saw at Midland with the trainer parade where you build it. Obviously, you talk about it at the safety brief, so we all know mm-hmm. we're on the same page in what we're doing. But that's where you have to become flexible
mm-hmm.
and adapt to, you know, the situation and build the schedule, you know.
That became apparent the first day compared to the second day.
Yeah.
You were like, oh, man, I'm so relaxed on the second day because we had already did it. And it was like, yeah, this is kind of weird. And everybody is like, oh, by the way. It was a learning experience for everybody involved, you know. So that was really cool to see.
The light bulb came on. And also, mm-hmm. that was my first trainer parade I've ever done. I put more CAF this year than ever. And it's been awesome.
And we definitely love to have you. Safety is an absolute paramount in aviation. Everything is based on safety in aviation. Could you elaborate on the safety protocols and procedures you implement or are required to be implemented to ensure the well-being of both pilots and spectators during air shows?
Yeah, so there's definitely a rule book on me as an air boss and the requirements that I have to have for a show. Starting all the way back to filing that paperwork, we are required to have an incident action plan in case there's an incident that happens. You know, who is it that's there? How are they going to respond? What are they going to do? Who's in charge? Who's not in charge? Because you don't want too many chiefs. Additionally, you have an emergency reaction plan or emergency response plan. Sorry, we don't react. We respond.
That's right.
And, that's all your fire and, you know, crash. And where they're going to be on the airfield in order to make that 60-second response time that's required, you know, by our 8900 regulation, which we have found very, very important, you know, in the past with accidents, stuff mm-hmm. like that. And then you, like I said, I have the tabletop when I get there and I meet with all the emergency response to ensure what they told me and what is on paper matches what they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
Day of, 30 minutes prior, we have all the emergency vehicles in place. We also, before the rehearsal day on Friday, we do an emergency response drill where we all either have a vehicle go out to a certain point on the airfield, pop smoke or something, and then tell the fire chief, hey, we have an aircraft down at this point. They have to respond, and I time them.
I like that. That's pretty cool.
Make sure that they get there within that 60 seconds on rehearsal day. Most of the time they do. We've only had one incident where they didn't. But then we do it again until they get it right because their response time and what they do is so important if we have happen.
Right. Yeah.
So, but we also talk safety in the briefing. We talk about, you know, altitude separation and who's holding and who's, you know, flying in the aerobatic box, who can be in that aerobatic box when someone else is performing. We talk about prepping for your performance. It's important because, you know, they're very, very, they're celebrities at an air show. And people right. always want pictures and always want to talk to them, but they have to separate themselves prior to their flight to get their mind right for what they're about to do. And we talk about that in the safety briefing. We foot stomp safety in those briefings and answer any questions there so there's not questions, you know, when they're out there.
Is the pilot brief required for pilots and crew or just pilots or who is it? Is it an absolute requirement for those flying?
Yeah, it's a requirement for anyone performing in the air show. It's called the essential personnel. You don't have to have the whole team there. So, you know, say F-22, I can have Raz there. I can have his SO there. You know, you don't have to have the whole crew. Can you imagine if the whole CAF crew came?
Oh, my goodness.
We would stadium.
Yeah. Could you imagine the entire blastered crew being there?
Oh, that
at Midland?
That would be fun.
That
would be a blast.
For other reasons. All right.
Funny, too.
Part-time comedian. Not only air boss, but part-time comedian.
Hey, I'm known for my safety briefs, for my memes and GIFs.
That's very true. That was so funny to see. It was Galveston. I was trying to think of the other air show that I've seen you at.
Yeah.
It was Galveston.
I have to throw humor in when I can. You know, these guys and gals sit through these briefings every weekend throughout the year.
Yeah, right. So. And it's the same thing over and over again. And then here comes Kellie just throwing a curveball.
Yeah, I don't have cool sayings like Wayne. Like, if you come down to my box like a bag of hammers or something like that, I have my...
How many days in advance do you get to the air show?
Depends, but typically I get there on a Wednesday morning. So the show's Friday, Saturday, Sunday, or the rehearsal's Friday. Thursday's our tabletop, me with emergency management. I like to get there on Wednesday so I can unpack and get oriented and, you know, get everything ready and do a little, you know, calm down for the show. So Wednesday typically in the afternoon.
Okay. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Weather conditions can be unpredictable, and especially coming from the South and moving into the Midwest up into the Northeast. If you've ever controlled in the Northeast, it's very unpredictable. How do you and your team handle changes in weather that could impact the scheduled performances?
Well, obviously in the safety briefing in the morning, we brief weather, but I call them weather predictors, not weather forecasters. Every time I say the weather is going to be great, something happens, you know, and it's like, where the heck did that come from? You know?
Yeah. Right.
So all we can do is, you know, you play it by ear. We're allowed 1500 foot ceiling, 3 miles biz. We can go down to 1,000 if, you know, the FAA IIC approves it. But, I had a couple shows this year where I had to knock it off. The performer couldn't go, and, you know, there was drizzle, there was rain. Some planes can handle some rain. Some planes can't. Obviously, safety's first, so you play it by ear. Or, for instance, this last weekend, I was at the Huntington Air Show, and just this 1 hour bit of weather rolls in, and it was supposed to be the F-22, F-35, and Heritage, and they got up in the air, and they're like, yeah, it's raining too bad, da-da-da-da-da, it's supposed to go away, you know, shortly. So Wayne, I was there, with Ray Shaw as his mini. Wayne was the boss, as Aaron Fitzgerald from Red Bull calls me, the wee boss that weekend. That's my new name, the wee boss.
The wee boss, okay. Yeah, I'll remember that.
Or they call me the wee boss. But anyways, no, they went back and landed. The ceiling was too low for the Golden Knights, so they were out. So what we did is we waited for about 30, 45 minutes for it to clear up, and then we had our full Heritage, you know, with the F-22 and Steve-O with the P-51 and Bayo, and then went on to, you know, the Thunderbirds. So you can move things around. You also want to be cautious about moving people that are way down in the schedule further up, because again, they need their time to prep for their show. And sometimes if it's more than one aircraft or a team, you know, reference Blues, Thunderbirds, Snowbirds, they have a specific regimented schedule, you know? So you just have to be flexible when it comes to weather. And sometimes you're the bad guy and you call it off because you don't know if it's going to stay for 30 minutes or 20 minutes. And I've been wrong in the past where it's like, it cleared up in 10, but the cell looked like it was more. And I could have ran probably one more person. So sometimes you're the bad guy when you make the call, but you know, it all comes down to instinct and what you feel at that moment is safe or unsafe, you know?
And not only rain, but I remember in Galveston being a heat index of like 112 and the air temperature was sky high. That was a safety too, because most of these airplanes don't have air conditioning.
Yep.
And a lot of them don't have windows that open or can be opened during performances.
Yeah. So, you know, that's another thing as an air boss, you'll get, you know, when you do the schedule, hey, can I go early in the morning because it's so hot? But when you have 10 of your 15 performers, that, I mean, you gotta stack them how you can stack them. Yeah, density altitude is pretty big too with these guys and gals flying in the show. You got to pay attention to that, and they also have to pay attention to that because a plane doesn't perform as it normally would if, you know, have such a high, you know, density altitude while they're flying.
Right.
So yeah, winds are also not just rain. The weather, it's hot. Usually they try to orchestrate these shows in the climates throughout the United States, but Galveston's a booger bear every year.
Guys, on that departure, as fast as you can get down there and right behind Southwest, I'm going to wait till that departure's off and then I'll launch my Taurus. Do you mind if when this guy is airborne and past the intersection that I launch these guys? Oh, sorry, you.
As long as he's through the intersection, I don't care.
Okay, and then I'll take it back after that.
Okay.
Thank you. Has Envoy called for clearance yet?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, because the next act after Spanky's is going to be pretty short, so if the tour is ready, they have about a 12-minute act, do you think?
Okay, he's got to call me on motion, I've got a good time for him.
Okay, so I'm going to bring that next act. I'll bring that next act in and then hold the other bombers for the second part.
Communication is key in aviation events. We just heard recordings of Airshow 23 in Midland of you talking with performers over the radio and also talking with the air traffic controllers in the tower we were in to ensure the movement of the airliners versus support vehicles and aircraft performers, etc. How do you manage communication between all of these people to ensure seamless coordination during the show?
Well, what was super awesome about that show, I had got to be in the tower, which is usually a little weird because I like to be right next to the announcer to cue them with hand gestures, sometimes, you know, whatever. But I was in the tower and I had also another certified air boss next to me that just has a few more boxes to check. So he was with me and he had, you know, his four flight up. So he's following the airliners. Obviously, they're on a schedule. So when I built the schedule for Midland, I made holes for the arrivals and departures. Not so worried about departures. They're a little bit easier to work. They're on the ground. But the arrival we had 14 arrival departures altogether within a 3.5 hour window of the show.
And who knew Midland was so busy?
Oh, my. I mean, I told Randy Ball about it. And he's like, this airport is like, the commercial traffic has gone up, you know, 40% over, you know, the year. But anyway, so these tower controllers, and I'm not just like tooting their horn because I was a, you know, tower radar controller for so long, more so tower, but they were phenomenal. It's about communication. It's about being direct, but also being kind and saying, hey, I need, you know, this guy at this point, at this time, can you make it work? So they would call down to the approach control and they would tell them, hey, give them a, you know, give them a S-turn or turn them this direction and make them, you know, be at this point at this time. And then I'd have Matt, my, you know, mini boss at that show, watching for flight to tell me how far they are. I mean, I would get 40-mile calls and my cutoff point is 5 miles with the airliners reference my axe. So it's all about, you know, the communication. I also had the announcer's assistant, Hallie, on my frequency. So she was listening. So as we're waiting on the airliners to come in, I'm very sure Spanky had some very colorful narration and entertained the crowd while I'm working, you know, airliners in. So it's all about communication and the people you surround yourself with. Make sure you're very clear and concise on your direction and what you need and what you want. And most of the time it works out. Sometimes there's some little, you know, kinks in it. But that show just seemed to be so amazing with that, you know, with the airliners. I had Dayton had the same thing this year with airliners commercial. That went well. And then Columbus, Ohio, Rickenbacker was another one this year with, so many airliners during an air show. So, again, communication, coordination, and being very clear in your intentions on what you need to make the production, you know, a production.
Yeah, standing behind y'all during the air show, watching you and Matt communicate together. Matt was communicating with the ground and the local controller and back and forth, and you talking to Hallie on frequency. It was like, this is absolute chaos, but it's working. This is so freaking cool. You know,
it's working. Yes, Aaron, it's organized. It's all purposeful.
Yeah, absolutely it is.
It's all part of the show.
Yeah.
I needed to like take a bow or do like a ballerina thing, but if I did the ballerina thing, I'm not very graceful, so I might have fallen down.
The role of an air boss requires strong understanding of aviation regulations and procedures. How do you stay up to date with the latest regulations and ensure compliance during events?
Well, so obviously regulations and rules are constantly changing. Thankfully, we have great people up at ICAS and great leaders within the airboss industry that write these regulations, review them, and rewrite them. You read. I mean, it comes down to reading the bulletins that come out, you know, from ICAS with updated regulations. The off season, when I'm not, I mean, I'm always in the 8900 reading it, the regulation stuff, because, you know, there's always questions that need to be answered and you can't be perfect and know it all. But in the off season, you dive into it. You know, it's all about knowledge and knowing what you're talking about. And if you don't have that, then I don't know how things work if you don't have the knowledge, you know, what you're supposed to be doing. So yeah, just keeping up on the procedures, the regulations that ICAS puts out to us. Tooch and Wayne are huge. They, when there's something new that comes out, you know, we get with the air bosses and we actually have phone conversations. We actually like each other and we talk, you know, hey, this happened at my show. Why did this happen? Okay, maybe we need to implement this, you know, maybe we implement this procedure or explain it a little better. So constant communication going on as we have a thread right now on email with all the air bosses talking about stuff for our upcoming convention when we get together.
Nice. Speaking of, what is ICAS?
Oh, International Council of Airshows. So they are the gods in the sky of airshows and events. I'm sure John and Dan will love that. I love those men. They have been so supportive of me, you know, over the years. But no, ICAS does our certifications, you know, follows the bosses, the pilots, you know, make sure we have, you know, everything we need to have. They send out, you know, regulations. They, we have a convention at the end of the year where we have workshops for not only bosses, but for performers, for support services, for producers of shows. And it's a place that ICAS brings everyone together at the end of the year without having a responsibility of a show the next day. And let's just say sometimes it gets a little hairy. But no, ICAS is our umbrella. They are the one that everything comes from ICAS to us. John and Dan do such a great job, you know, doing what they do.
So basically, you are certified under ICAS, working with the FAA and others to ensure that this show that you're putting on and orchestrating goes smoothly and safely and under regulation.
Yeah, so I'm certified by the FAA through ICAS, yes.
Oh, perfect.
Okay. Yeah, we as bosses, once we get our cert, every 3 years, we have to get recerted. So I just got recerted for another three.
Sweet.
Yeah.
Could you share a memorable moment or experience from your career as an air boss and what made that particular event stand out to you?
There's so many. And, you know, obviously, as Wayne says, Kelly, you love everyone. I do. I love each and every person I come in contact with. And if you haven't gotten a hug from me and you hear this podcast, make sure you grab me when you see me because I give the best hugs.
Truth.
Right. Yeah. I would say everything came full circle for me when I retired out of Nellis Air Force Base in Las Vegas, and I got to do the Nellis show this past year in November of 2022. I was the air boss for the show, not a mini. I was the boss for the show, did it from beginning to end. And it was also really, really cool because that was Cabo. If, you know, I'm sure everyone remembers Cabo. He's not a has-been. He's still around. Raptor F-22 pilot. He and I were friends prior. And he's the one that was there when I learned about the Airboss program. And then he called me about a year later. He's like, hey, Kel, I think I'm going to put in to be a Raptor demo pilot. I'm like, that would be cool. Maybe we get to work together.
Right.
Well, we never did in all the years that he did it until Nellis. So full circle, retired out of Nellis Air Force Base, Tower Raider, got to do that show and got to do it with my buddy for his last show in the airshow industry as a Raptor pilot.
That is so cool.
Had the survivor party at my house. Mm-hmm. So we all know Bill Stein and Rob Holland do not party and they do not go out. And they, you know, I had them at the house. I had, you know, Greg Colker, Tim Tebow, not the football player. But, yeah, F-22 team, F-35 team. I mean, we had them all over here. So I think just having them in my home, being where I say where I'm from now, I've been here 13 years, Nellis had to be the most memorable moment so far, you know, in air show. Even though I love many of the air shows I do, Nellis was it for me that last year. It was really cool.
That was pretty cool. And just surfing through your socials and seeing those pictures of what you were just talking about with all the big name pilots of the Air Force and of the airshow community was like, whoa, that is so cool. Like to have Raz and Cabo and whatnot, just like being, I dare say, personal friends.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, that is so cool. A lot of people look up to those people, and I'm sure a lot of people look up to you as well.
Oh. Well, you know, the cool thing about Bill and Rob in my home was the first show that I ever worked, like when I was training, was in Minden, Nevada, and Tooch was bossing, and Bill and Rob said, "We are not flying on Sunday unless you let Kelly brief and work it."
Wow.
And I'm like, and they recorded me to show me, and then they coached me. They're like, "Great job, but here's some insight. Here's some, you know," so they have been there. Same with Red Bull, Aaron. I mean, those performers have been there since I started. So it's pretty cool to have them now be like, "Great job, boss." Like,
right.
Build it, you know? So super.
That's so cool.
Full circle.
Yeah. It's not only, you know, you're not just boss, you thank tower controllers when you leave the airspace and this and that, and they're not just a voice on the radio when you're in the air show. You personally know these people, and that's so, so cool.
Oh yeah. And I take that very seriously. I always these are my friends. These aren't airplanes. These
mm-hmm.
are
That's right.
Get to them.
That's right.
Yep.
With the continuous advancement of technology, how do you see the role of an airboss evolving in the future? For example, with the experience that I had with you and Airboss Matt at AIRSHO in Midland, I've seen some of the technology come into play with Matt being on his iPad with four flight running to see where the arrivals and departures were and whatnot. Are there any new tools or techniques that you believe will enhance your ability to manage air shows?
I mean, obviously the four flight is amazing. You know, it helps us to see, especially when you don't have, you know, a tower controller there, you're just, you know, on a unicom uncontrolled airport. Four flight is essential to be able to see, because not everyone's going to call you, read TFRs, read NOTAMs and whatnot. So I would say that's
apparent in Midland.
Yeah. Yeah. Some, I like my wind indicators. Not all airfields have wind socks. So I'm usually looking at like Huntington Beach. We were looking at the flag. Which way was the flag, you know, flowing? Stuff like that. A lot of times we're just estimating the winds. Some sound guys have like a little wind indicator there. I would like to have that whole setup for myself. You know, I have the four flight with the iPad, you know, myself, because mm-hmm. I do not rely on someone else to tell me about traffic. But I don't know any other. I mean, I don't think we're going to go AI, or, you know, I don't think bosses are going to become, you know, I mean, I think it's important that we're there physically, right? Because things.
Oh, absolutely. There's a lot of things that you can't do that AI can't do that a human can do.
Yeah.
You know, and especially with the adapting as, you know, and not as fast as that as we can either.
Yeah.
You know, it takes time to process the stuff and say, okay, now what do we do? Yep. Whereas you said earlier, you have plans implemented and ready to go.
Mm-hmm.
You know exactly what to do. You just have to think of, okay, this is what happened. I'm going to this plan, initiate, yep. You know, whereas AI, I don't think.
Can you imagine airboss like Avatar?
Oh my goodness. that would be just a screen on a show center.
Yeah.
That's.
I don't
know.
No. Humor too. So it's kind of important, you know, when we're flying, you know, we do have little moments where we banter back and forth and whatnot. But no, I think just in a nutshell, you already mentioned it. We had it at Midland. We have it at multiple other shows where we have, you know, four flight up and we're watching, you know, incoming, because you can never be too safe. And obviously if ADSB is not on, you're not going to see it. And you play those by ear, but again, safety is paramount, and that's a huge thing, you know, that iPad with the four flight, having someone watching that. So I don't know any other technology really that I can think off the top of my head, you know, besides more intel on what's in your airspace or around your airspace. You know, it's very good to a local controller. Usually we'll have someone from the approach control be on the stand with us doing coordination, you know, with the approach control facility instead of us having to call. So that alleviates, you know, another task for us as bosses.
Right.
And they know the airspace more so than we do.
Right. And that's where they work every single day.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
For individuals aspiring to become air bosses, what advice do you offer? What skills, experiences, and qualities are essential for success in this unique and demanding role?
Oh, yeah. So I don't think there's like a set like thing that's like, you don't have, like I told you earlier, you don't have to be an air traffic controller. I mean, some of the, you know, guys that have been around for a while are prior controllers, but now I'm looking at, you know, my counterparts, my other, you know, people that work with me as air bosses, they're pilots. Mm-hmm. I think I have one that's an architect, but also flies, you know? So I think the willingness, if you want to get into it, willingness to learn the industry, you have to be able to be, you know, personable and network, because if the pilots don't like you or the performers don't like you, it's not good. They're not going to mm-hmm. work with you. I mean, not that they're going to do anything, you know, unsafe, but reliability, dependability, flexibility, being able to build relationships with the people, support systems, the announcers, sound, the producers of the show is so important. And also knowing the regulations, what you can do, what you can't do, is super important. So I actually have my first mentee that will be traveling with me next year to a couple of shows, which was an honor to receive that email. But I just start to, you know, here's the 8900, read it. And then we'll start discussing it, you know? So they just have to be able to, sometimes you got to speak in a certain way to certain people to get things done. Not being mean, but you have to be able to communicate well with people in order to get the show to where you want it to go. And I don't think every single person is made to be an air boss or built to be one, however you want to say it. I think it's a skill that you have to have a little bit of at the start, but then you can build on it. Kind of like these guys built me up for, you know, 3 years before I was on my own and doing my own shows. And now I'm about to start teaching people how to do it.
Look at you now, kid.
I know, right? They can see me now.
Do you have any performances coming up you want to plug? And will you be at ICASCon?
Okay, so I am not the air boss at Houston, at Wings Over Houston, but I will be there. I'm going to be blowing stuff up with blasters.
All right.
My forms, yep. So get ready, performers. I'm going to help them, the announcer, and blasters make y'all look good.
Sweet.
Yeah, Tasha and Bill Roach, they're just phenomenal human beings. So, and I'm from Houston, so I'm going back home, check on the parents, also attend an air show, show some of my childhood friends what an air show is, not just Galveston, but like a huge one.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Following Houston, right up there, I jump over to Jack's Beach. So Jack's Beach with the Blue Angels, myself and Matt Jolly, and then Jay Rabbit will be there. And then Stewart, the all famous Stewart Air Show outside West Palm Beach. Do it every year. It's where I got my certification. Definitely have a deep, deep, deep love for that show. And I'll be heading to Stewart to do that with Tooch. And then on to a cruise with some of the teams for end of year. And then, yes, I will be at ICAST every single day since I am jobless.
Jobless.
But... yeah, jobless. I do what I love. Airbossing is not a job. So, no, I'll be there every day, walking around. I don't have a booth this year. I plan on getting one next year. And being out there on the floor, but I will be walking around, so find me for hugs.
Sweet.
Yeah.
You mentioned a big part of the job is networking.
Yeah.
But you've mentioned a few times, and I know a couple of your shows, literally you left Midland to go to Savannah, and I just have to ask a question. How do you get involved with the military air demonstrations? Like,
or like with the teams or
what? Yeah, with the teams. Like you said that you're going to do the F-22 Raptor demo in Savannah, and then you're going what was the other one? Jack's Beach, and then something else. Is it hard to get involved with the military guys, or is it just what you said, networking? Does networking work in that way?
Yeah, so you know, I'm a networker, not by, you know, oh, I'm going to network today. I'm just a personable person. Some people love me. Some may hate me. I don't know. But Raz called me up and was like, Kel, I need your help. Can we do this? We need to make this happen for the Tybee Island flyover. First time, or not flyover, demo. So William Tell is a big exercise they used to do at Savannah Hilton Head. It hasn't happened, I think, in like 17 or 19 years. And they brought it back. and the base commander wanted to show off, you know, the air power that we have in the Air Force. So Raz started doing it, and obviously he has shows probably every weekend, like more so than I do. And he's like, Bell, I need help with, you know, paperwork. Can you boss this show? So that was all like word of mouth. That was Raz working with me at other shows. And we click. He knows I'm going to get stuff done. He also likes my memes and GIFs and my briefs. he always asks, are you going to put them in there? Bayo does too. that was a word of mouth. That was, hey, I've got the perfect boss for this. And of course I said, yes, sir. Of course I will do this. It was a challenge. That was a big challenge. I'm sure you heard me talking about it at Midland, like oohing and on about it. But that it airbossing is a lot of it is word of mouth. If they do, they're going to recommend you. Alf Midland, I picked up another show next year, so I'll be doing the
awesome
homecoming.
Sweet.
Yeah.
And then if you don't know who it is, for the listeners, if you don't know who she's talking about, it's Sam Larson. He's the F-22 demo pilot. And Bayo is Kristen Bayo Wolf. She's the F-35 pilot.
Yep.
Which I just learned that Wings Over Houston lost the A-10s, but gained the F-35.
Oh, yeah.
Which is so cool. I can't wait to see it because I haven't seen one in person yet. So
really?
I can't wait for that. Yeah.
She's big. Not Bayo.
Yeah.
Not Bayo. Yeah. I just left her and Steph Strickland, Strickland, not Land, at Huntington. So they're both... You know, we hugged, and they're my inner circle, those two. And we hugged and said, see ya in 8 days, you know. So we get to be reunited in Houston, which is really cool. Although Matt is a pretty awesome person who's the A-10 demo pilot.
Mm-hmm.
Hate to see her go, but working on some stuff with her for next year.
Sweet. Can't wait. A-10s are still cool. Do you have a favorite performer?
I don't have a favorite performer in the fact that they all bring a different dynamic. You know, the air show, how do you pick out of so much amazingness, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But the very first fighter plane that I ever worked and that I fell in love with right when I saw it was the A-10 attack.
Oh, yeah.
So I love the A-10. Everyone knows I love the A-10. It's not a secret. I'm not going to say they're my favorite performer, but I will say they're my favorite aircraft.
They're so cool, too. I
know.
The sound of them, and they're low attack, and my goodness, it's so freaking cool.
I hope we have a couple more years with them.
Yeah, I hope so. I hope so, too.
Yeah.
Shout out to Amy Rebel Fielder as well. Oh. I got to meet her and Tyler. That was so cool. She's so cool.
Yeah, I haven't even got to work with her this year. We were just talking about that. Great friend of mine and her family. Amazing people. And I'll get to be with her now and Stuart. So she'll
awesome.
Be flying at Stuart with Raptor demo.
Awesome. Going back to the beginning of the interview, I forgot to ask you this. Do you have a favorite base that you controlled at for the Air Force and civilian? Looking back at your time in the Air Force, where was your favorite place to control? And then now, do you have a favorite favorite airport that you like to visit, or have you bossed at your favorite airport, or you gained a favorite?
So military-wise, when I was in the service, you know, that's kind of hard to answer. I was at Maxwell Air Force Base, super-duper slow, you know. I was there for 10 years, minus my tour to Korea. Obviously that's my, you know, first love where I learned and I still keep in touch with, you know, everybody from there. But I'd have to say, and this is kind of weird, and I think I was talking to Raz about this the other day, when I was in Balad, Iraq in 05 in the tower, it brought on a lot of challenges, single runway, multiple different, wars and different, you know, stuff going on.
Different operations.
Oh my, that's the word. Thank you. So many operations, and planes are coming from all directions on the ground, and then they're going out, and then you have certain procedures in place that you have to adhere to. And if someone doesn't adhere to it, then it changes. So you have to, but it was so fun. It was so fun just adapting to every little change, or, you know, if a pilot didn't listen to what you said, or if you have multiples coming in that are different speeds coming back from a mission, or whatever. There were so many different moving parts that I was just saying, like, I really, really enjoyed my time, minus the mortars and the war part. I really enjoyed controlling at that airport because you had such freedom to move people around and everyone was willing to, you know, maneuver as needed versus, mm-hmm. you know, who was coming back in from what mission and who needed to be on the ground, who was critical type stuff. So that was super awesome tower to control out of. It was a plywood tower in the center of the airfield on a lighting vault because our Iraqi tower was shut down for renovations. So that also made it challenging.
Interesting.
So that, yeah, the military. And then I have a love for the Stewart Air Show.
Mm-hmm.
Although Nellis is my home, I call Stewart my home show. I love controlling there. I love the people there. I guess I'm not controlling. I love bossing there. The IIC is awesome. She's Lizette. She cried. I've never met Lizette. She's pretty awesome. But there with me, Dewey, who produces the show, all the volunteers there, and just, it's a really, really awesome show.
Mm-hmm. That's so cool.
So, yeah, but it's my number one show that I love and look forward to at the end of every year on Veterans Day weekend.
Sweet.
Yeah.
Would you like to share your socials, and do you have any shout-outs to share?
I do have a couple socials. My Instagram is Hudson_airshows. Hudson_airshows is my my air boss social. If people want to find me on Facebook, it's just Kelly Lynn Hudson.
Any shout outs?
Oh, just shout out to everyone who's supported me. This industry is so welcoming. And it is in such a transition stage of people retiring and moving on. So I just shout out all my air bosses that helped me get to where I am today, you know, trained me, taught me, schooled me, sometimes slapped my hand. So many performers that I get feedback from, as you saw at the Midland show.
Mm-hmm.
I appreciate any feedback. Matt Jolly gave me some feedback this weekend. And at my announcers, gosh, I there's so many people that have just supported me throughout this last 5.5 years that I would be here for 5 days, you know, talking about all of them. But there's more to air shows than performers. There's support services. And when you have the support of them at different shows, they're huge as well. Mm-hmm. So I don't think that the support services get enough hype, you know?
Right. And I think personally, your personality kind of fine tunes that, and you're easy to get along with and easy to talk to. So,
well, I love everyone.
Anything else you want to add?
No, I look forward to, you know, working with, you know, more performers that are up and coming. We're always looking for new acts. We're always looking for the, you know, the, as Wayne would say, the best of the best of the best. So yeah, please don't hesitate to reach out to me if you're wanting to be an air boss or wanting to get your foot in the door in the air show industry. I can always direct you to where you need to go. But buckle up. It is a fun ride, and I would not trade it, you know, for anything else. You know, there's some sad moments. There's very happy moments. But we are a family at the end of the day, and I could not be happier to have been invited into this crazy family that I'm in now.
So finally, I personally love baseball, and every time a player walks up to the batter's box, they have a clip of a song to play. If you had to choose a walk-up track where you're walking to show center, up on the stand, up in the tower, what would that song be and why?
So I thought about that one, and I'm like, gosh, that's a tough question. And I was thinking about, like, woman, I am woman, hear me roar type stuff, and I'm like, that is not it. So I think that, like, I was looking, and I think we're going to go with, to make it more to the times now, and I'm not going back to the 80s,
mm-hmm.
The song Let's Go by Neo, because, you know, it's like we're pumping up for a, you know, for a game or for a production or for a show, and it's, you know, it's not about, it says, it's not about what you've done, it's about what you're doing. It's all about where you're going, no matter where you've been. And not a lot of people know, you know, my whole story of where I came from and how I got to where I am. But that song describes me. Like, it doesn't matter what you've done in your life or where you've been. It's all about, you know, the future, looking forward and where you're going. And then it says, let's go. That's what I always say. like, let's go, let's do this, you know? So I think that would be in a hype song. So it gets everyone excited and whatever. So maybe one day that'll be my, when the air boss walks on the sand, they're playing it. There's not a whole lot of words, but the words that there are very meaningful. No, it's a totally cool song that's relatable to, you know, I guess all generations trying to bring in the next generation. So that would probably be the best thing that describes like what's going on in my head. Like, how did you get here, Kel? You made it. So let's go, you know?
Let's go.
Yeah.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
Awesome. All right. Well, Kellie, thank you so much for taking the time out of your day to come talk with me. And also, thank you so very much for letting me experience an air show from a whole new perspective in the Midland Tower at AIRSHO 23. It was truly an amazing experience all around, from seeing the performers up close and personal, quite literally, and also getting to know you and seeing you work and what you do. It was an amazing experience, and I hope you we get to do it again soon. And again, thanks for being on from the right seat, and we'll talk again soon.
All right, I'll see you soon, and you're always welcome on the stand for the tower with me.
Sweet. I love that invitation.
Yeah.
There you have it, aviation enthusiasts. Our journey with Kellie Hudson, the maestro of the skies above air shows and air displays alike, has come to a close. We've soared through the intricacies of air show coordination, listened to the live beats of air show radio and communication between Airboss and ATC, and gained insight into the remarkable effort it takes to make an event of this magnitude possible. A special thanks to Kellie for sharing her expertise and passion with us today. Remember, the sky is not the limit, it's just the beginning. Until our next flight, blue skies and tailwinds. Thank you for joining us on this high-flying adventure. If you've enjoyed this episode and want more thrilling aviation stories, don't forget to hit the subscribe button and leave us a review. Your support fuels our passion to bring you more incredible journeys from the skies. Spread the word to fellow aviation enthusiasts, and let's keep soaring together. Safe travels, and see you on the next episode of From the Right Seat.